It's cheap, it's smelly, and it's full of microorganisms. And I'm not talking about me. I'm talking about Infusoria. Infusoria, it's all the rage, I think. It's a great, cheap, easy way to feed your tiny baby fish. Betta fry love this stuff. At least that's what people tell me. Because I just can't seem to do it. I've tried. Maybe I should explain what Infusoria is. It's a way that you can culture an assortment of tiny little microorganisms, and then you take that and feed it to your baby fish. Because tiny little fry can be hard to feed a lot of species, including betta fish. They're so little, and in order to survive and eat at that tiny, tiny stage, they need an assortment of little microorganisms to eat. Because an aquarium environment might not have a lot of those little microorganisms to sustain a large spawn. Supposedly, from what I hear, there are a lot of different ways you can culture these infusoria, and then you can draw from that culture to feed your fish. The whole idea is this. You let something decay in a jar of aquarium water. Then a population of bacteria will bloom and start to eat that decaying matter. That bacteria will then get eaten by the infusoria, or the collection of microorganisms in the water. And in turn, that population of microorganisms will bloom, and then you'll have stuff to feed your little tiny fry. In my case, betta fry. According to tons of YouTube videos and shorts, this is supposed to be really easy. Oh, look at this one, it's like a stew. I'm salivating just looking at this. From a betta fry's perspective, of course. These people, these people. Some start with lettuce, some start with yeast, some start with banana leaves, some start with banana peels. They add in aquarium water, they wait. And a few days or a week or so later, depending on temperatures, I think, their jars are teeming with these scrumptious little microorganisms. Like, this is just one of my attempts. One of my infusoria attempts. I started this one about 2.5 weeks ago with some lettuce. I started this one with a piece of dog kibble and some instant yeast. And I started this big one right here with a banana peel. And I'm a failure with all three of them. I've also learned that infusoria cultures can be finicky and unreliable. And why are they finicky and unreliable? Well, I think because there's so many factors, including stuff coming from your aquarium water that's predating on the infusoria that you're trying to culture, which it must be happening to me. But there's another way. To start a paramecium culture, a clean, isolated paramecium culture. Why am I so concerned with this stuff anyway? Taylor, you feed your new betta fry vinegar eels. Vinegar eel cultures are so easy and so reliable. By the way, you can buy them from me on my website if you want. I guess I just want the experience. I really do like the idea of newly hatched, newly free swimming little fry having just a assortment, a smorgasbord of tiny little live foods to eat that are just swimming in the aquarium water, and they're just right there whenever the fish need them. For the first few days of these fish's lives, I want that. I think that paramecium would be a wonderful option to feed betta fry before vinegar eels even. It's like, I've always known about paramecium, I've just never tried them because I would have to pay $20 for a starter culture, but I just decided to do it for the sake of experimentation. Also because Gian from Inglorious Bettas did it. I saw a great video by Fish Easy, and he was showing his cultures, and they were so full of paramecium, and that's exactly what I want. Also, Lowell's Fish Lab has a really great video on culturing paramecium, and they convinced me. Here's my starter culture. This is Paramecium aurelia. I got it from Carolina Biological Supply. They're usually used in classroom experiments. Today I'll be starting a paramecium culture and a few different infusoria cultures at the same time, and then monitoring them and comparing them. I'll start by remaking my infusoria cultures. I'll go dump these smelly things out in my garden, and then I'll try again. I guess the dog kibble one's not so smelly. The lettuce one's kind of smelly. The banana peel one was absolutely foul. I hope my dog doesn't roll in it. Is that the face of a dog who's gonna roll in that? No.
So precious.
Okay, I am remaking those infusoria cultures. I've got four clean glass jars. One of them gets a piece of lettuce. It's like the most common way that you see online to make infusoria. One of them gets some dried banana leaves. A lot of Asian breeders recommend dried banana leaves, so I'm gonna do it. One of them gets a dog kibble. And the last one gets some banana peel. I'll just do a little chunk. Filling these up about halfway with boiling water. Obviously let them cool to room temperature. I'll fill up the rest of the jars with some aquarium water. And I've started four infusoria cultures. Now I'll put them in a place with lots of indirect light and just wait. Now I'll do the new paramecium culture. This one requires a few ingredients. For this, I have some sterilized glass jars, some spring water, you'll see why. I have some wheat berries. They're super cheap. This was like $2. I have a little instant yeast. And of course, my cute little paramecium. I'll count out some wheat berries. I want about 10 per jar. I boiled those for 10 or 15 minutes. These are my sterilized jars. It cooled down and I poured the water into these jars. Now I'll distribute the wheat berries evenly, about 10 per jar. Now the reason that I had spring water is so that I can do a little experiment. Two of these jars are going to be using spring water from the grocery store, and two of the jars will be using my tap water. Apparently, different tap waters can affect paramecium in different ways because they're very, very sensitive. I'm adding the tiniest sprinkle of yeast to each jar. The yeast will slowly consume the wheat berry. The paramecium will consume the yeast. I'll take my sample culture of the paramecium. I can see tiny little specks in there, and I'll distribute it evenly between the four jars. Cover them so nothing gets in. I'm using some spare surgical masks for this. It's been about 6 days since I made the cultures. Let's check in and compare the two. Paramecium versus infusoria. I think I need a lapel microphone or something. It's really echoey in here. This box here is full of my paramecium jars. They don't need light, which is kind of nice. I brought my paramecium culture into the pantry so I could have some darkness to show you guys the paramecium. They're attracted to light, so I have a flashlight shining right there, and if I zoom in, you can see all those scrumptious little floating specks. Oh God, yes, look at that. See all the swimming specks? That's what I wanted. Pure, unadulterated, uncut paramecia. I can't wait to test these guys out on a new spawn. Now I'll show you the infusoria, and you are not gonna believe this crap. My infusoria cultures actually like half worked this time. Out of all of my unsuccessful infusoria cultures over the years that I've tried it, all of a sudden when I make a video about it and I whine and complain online, it works. So here's what it looks like when it works. After a few days in a warm location, look at this, visible to the naked eye, swirling around, absolutely mouth-watering. This is the one made with lettuce leaves. It's the best. Look at all of these little delicious swirling masses. You can see the lines of the infusoria like sinking down towards the bottom. Scrumptious. The dog kibble one with yeast, I see some little amount of movement in there. It's not as obvious as the lettuce one. The culture made using the dried banana leaves looks the least cloudy, but I see all kinds of little specks swimming around in there, which is nice. It doesn't seem very dense. It's certainly not as dense as the lettuce one. The banana peel one, I don't see anything working. It's just cloudy water. I'm not seeing anything really move around in it. It sort of looks like stuff's moving around in this clip, but it's because I bumped the jar and I moved it slightly. I'm not totally sure that this one's going to be successful, but I don't know. Maybe it just needs to sit for another week. From what I gather, if the infusoria culture doesn't work, you're not gonna be able to see the movement with your eyes, and it's gonna stay cloudy, I think. And that's what I was dealing with for forever. I just had cloudy water and I couldn't see any movement in it. Okay, real talk for a bit. Let's compare the two. Infusoria, cheap, easy, not necessarily reliable. It's a little unpredictable. I would hate to be relying on infusoria cultures and have them fail when I needed them most. And why do they fail? I don't know. Maybe it has to do with the aquarium water that you start with. Like when you go take your scoops of aquarium water, it really depends on what's in that. Like, do you have little predators, little things in there that are feeding on the infusoria? Maybe luck makes a big difference. The isolated paramecium culture did splendidly. No fuss, each jar is successful, it seems more predictable. The big con is that you have to spend some effort or some money to get a pure culture sample. Or you have to know somebody who has it, you have to have friends. In order to maintain it, you have to keep it somewhat sterile. You can't be contaminating your pure paramecium culture on accident with other microorganisms, like from a pipette or from a pair of tongs that you use. You have to be careful and maintain the sterility of the culture. Because what if you introduced something that predated on your paramecium? It'd ruin your culture and you'd have to start over. Just something to think about. Okay, before I round this out, I have one thing to say that I have beef with. Some people say that even if you can't visually see with your eyes stuff moving around in your infusoria culture, that it's still there, that it's still technically successful, because even all the little bacteria and whatnot that you can't see, fry can see and they can eat it. But I don't like that idea. Like, if I can't see with my eyes what's in the culture, how do I know I'm not just feeding my precious little baby fish some stale, stagnant bacteria water? Like, I don't want to be putting that in my little precious fry tanks. I don't like that idea. I want to be able to see it with my eyes. That's why I like vinegar eels so much, and I quite like this paramecium idea. I'm gonna stick with it. And for the fish that I spawn next, I will be feeding them paramecium as their very first food. And we'll see how it goes. Thanks so much for watching, guys. Feel free to leave comments on your experience with infusoria. Do you use it? Is it easy? Is it a pain? Would you try paramecium? Thanks so much for watching, you bunch of fish nerds. Have a great day, and I'll see you next time.